Please note that though this is a spoiler-free review of the subject, I do spoil the series and or franchise leading up to this particular entry. Put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. The Matrix Revolutions mood review. This picks up exactly where the Matrix Reloaded stopped. Note my choice of words. Expecting us to remember anything about the Matrix Reloaded stopping other than the huge disappointment that it stopped rather than ended after not having an action climax. This, you know, it almost stands to reason that this does not stand alone. It also does not do anything to recap. Keeping in mind, this did come out 6 months after The Matrix Reloaded. I was not one of the people who, you know, only went and watched it the one time, the, you know, exactly when it came out, and then didn't really, you know, didn't go back and, you know, try to figure out everything that happened, so and so, but some people might have, and you should be able to. Anyway, to go into detail about how this opens. Neo and Bane are both unconscious in the medical section of the hammer. And no, you are not going to like what happens when either of them wakes up. In 12 hours, the machines will breach the docks of Zion. And that's basically it. There's really no plot here, although the you know, at least we do have a mystery opening where, you know, the first one had a lot of mystery to it. The second one, not really. And now we do have some again, you know, the first, you know, when we do see Neo first wake up and his surroundings and his situation, there is a mystery there. There is something new we learn. And as others have pointed out, like Reloaded, this feels soulless. And depending on who you ask, the problems of two are either back or just reversed. Personally, I'd say it's mostly that they're back. You know, the franchise has gone down a hole, all right? When Reloaded came out, people were still, you know, the you know, it sounded like it might be good. The marketing made it seem like it was good, and everybody loved the first one. So, you know, people were a little less inclined, you know, critics and viewers alike were a little less inclined to admit that it sucked. So it still got pretty decent reviews. With this one, people were ready for it to suck, although not anywhere near as much as it did. But it did get torn apart. This lost 66% of total earnings in the second week. On the tomato meter, the first one has a very well-deserved 87%. The second has 73%. See what I mean about them going easy on it? This one has 36. Yeah. This, you know, some say that this gives okay closure to the second, and certainly to the overall story of the trilogy. But really, a lot of what is brought up in the second one really isn't followed up on here. Like, you see some of the same characters. Maybe some of the issues are brought up, but largely, yeah, a lot of what's in the second, it's just there as questions, you know, ideas to put forth. And that's fine for a franchise, but for a sequel that's already so full, like, a lot of the characters that are in the second are back here. And there is something, like, they do stuff. So, you know, the fact that they've returned, the fact that they're in the second movie makes sense, because they had to be in the third movie as well. But a lot of the ideas posed in the second movie, they're just philosophical ideas for the audience to go home and ponder. And so we sat in the movie theater and got all this, you know, all this exposition, all this dialogue that doesn't mean anything for the trilogy. That doesn't actually, like, it's not that. Some of the ideas in the first one are here in the third one as well, and they do actually, you know, they help to explain stuff, or they go somewhere with it. But yeah, a lot of what's in the second, it's just there. And that's where, in the comics and in the animatrix and such, there are also a lot of ideas that don't necessarily get resolved within, they're just brought up, and something, and it leaves you something to ponder. That's fine. It's just taking place within the Matrix universe. But in the trilogy, we expect everything to actually go together and pay off. You know, the first one, there really isn't very much that doesn't at all pay off in some way. And the hammer, the, you know, Mjolnir, Thor's hammer, gets to live up to its name. The Jeff Darrow, who designed, you know, quite a bit of the real-world stuff, right from the first movie, calls it the Bismarck, the Potemkin. It's the warship of the, you know, it's a big and really heavy, yeah, it's yeah, and he took inspiration from panzer tanks and the like. This has one of the single worst covers of any DVD that I have ever seen. It's four different pictures placed, you know, in two rows of two. And they're just there. There's no like feathering between them. There's no blending together. No, it's just, they're just there. It looks like it was done in 5 minutes by that intern who hasn't really learned how to use Photoshop yet. He just knows that he can take different pictures and put them together in one picture. It's baffling. Going to last minute notes. The Merovingian is in this, briefly. When he meets Morpheus and Trinity, first he says, in French, so they might have figured that it would go past a lot of people, he says, what a nice surprise, what a good surprise, you know. And then he says, I know why you're here. I get that. The idea must be that now that you are here, I know what would have sent you here, but then, how, still a surprise? And then Morpheus, you know, tries to kind of cut through, you know, he watched the second movie. He remembers the Merovingian. He doesn't want him to go on this long rant again, so he tries to kind of cut to the chase. And then Merovingian says, Morpheus, always straight to business. That French accent may be at least a little bit worse than the Merovingians. Did you watch the first two movies? Morpheus never gets straight to the point. Morpheus always goes into these long monologues before he gets to the point. And, you know, Seraph meets with Morpheus and Trinity to try to help them get Neo back, and when the first thing they try doesn't work out, he's immediately like, we have to go back to the Oracle. When the course of action is kind of obvious, and I think it's Trinity who says, no, we just have to do, you know, Seraph must be really codependent. And then later, he tries to hide from the Smiths. He must be one of those people who plays Outlast and doesn't realize that the hiding works best if then when, you know, who's the, you know, the person who's looking for you comes really close, then you bolt out and run past them, surprising them. He just hides and hopes for the best. And the... Locke explains to the council that in order to stop the machines, he will need so and so much of their military force. And when he says half the infantry corps, Councilman West, Cornell West, Brother West says, half the infantry, proving that even with just a few lines, even one line of dialogue, a short line of dialogue, he can still show that the man is not an actor. Apologies, Brother West. Big fan of your philosophy and thinking on things, but not. Don't get in front of the camera for an acting gig, that's all. He says half the infantry. It's an invasion. What else would they be doing? If Locke had said, I want to put all of the military in this one spot, even though we know that they might come through two different spots. But that's not what he says. He says, we have to put all our military in this one spot where the machines are going to come through. And then the council... Locke follows it up by saying, if I could, I would put every man, woman, and child in Zion with a weapon in front of the machines. That I would understand them protesting. That's a bit much. A lot of these people, even if they, you know... Even if you were okay with them giving up their lives, they might not exactly be able to put up much of a fight. It would be a slaughter. But mobilizing a lot of the military kind of makes sense. I feel like they really wanted to make the military position sound less like, you know, and really, you know, he's not this arrogant, you know, he's not like saying bullets can't pierce the brave hearts of Zionists, I guess. He's saying, I need the military because I'm the military guy in charge, and their military is actually kind of attacking us, so we need to use the military to stop them. He has several big strategic moments. They make sense. He's not like throwing everything over and having to be, you know, having to let someone else take charge because he's like not good at, no, yeah. The kid, still in the trilogy, still in these two sequels, tries to become part of the I guess it's the infantry. He helps reload the badass APUs, the mech suits. When the captain of the APU corps, I think, he gets into an APU and he, you know, yells a, you know, discount Braveheart speech at the other APU people. Anyway, he meets the kid and then he says, he basically says, "You're too young for this." And the kid says, "The machines don't care how, don't care how old I am. They'll kill me just the same." And most of the audience said, "We will. You don't have to wait for the machines." Anna Espinosa, also in this, like the second one, at one point tries to talk the other female character who's related to Tank Dozer and Link, who we really don't care about. She says, "This is crazy." Anna Espinosa would know crazy when she saw it. Neo and Trinity have this, really heartfelt, when they, after they, rejoin each other. And they do that thing in movies where loved ones whisper to each other, and it's just like, it's wow, yeah. When you break it down, the actual action scenes by themselves don't take up that much of the movie. I've seen movies where it's basically just action over and over again, and it wears you down, and you're just waiting for it to end. At the end of the day, the individual action scenes here don't last all that too long. It's just kind of that they weren't really what we wanted. And that at one point, a character smiles, and then another says, "Is this real?" I can understand why a character just smiled in a major, and it's not even a small, it's a big smile. So it's, yeah, there's something off here. This does develop Morpheus some. He gets to leave his comfort zone some. I love Morpheus, but in a sequel, you kind of want to mix it up a little bit. You kind of want, and that is at the very end of Reloaded, they finally try to take his character somewhere new. In all of One and almost all of Reloaded, he's just, chief priest of the movement of the prophecy. He's the spiritual leader basically, and nothing really happened. He's always just like, that's the, at least in the first one, they don't, he doesn't necessarily get into a lot of different places for his character, but he does. We see him in very different situations. We see how far he's willing to go for Neo and how strong his faith is in Neo. But then the second one, yeah, his faith is still strong, and he's just waiting for the Oracle to tell them what to do, and so they'll do it. And then when the Oracle tells Neo something, then he's like, "Okay, then we'll do it." And then they do it. And finally, at the very end, he has a crisis of faith. And in this, they follow up on that some. And they also have a little bit fun of fun with him, which, is greatly appreciated in a Matrix sequel. The first one again, in Mouse is fun. We have some fun with the Cypher giving Neo a drink is, has some, there's some fun little bits around that, various. Yeah, but in Reloaded, not that much fun. But they make him the co-pilot to Niobe because Niobe has, she's the best pilot, the movie tells us over and over. And so he's not flying the ship, and he's not, excuse me, he's not giving the orders as he's used to. And he's not like, some haughty kind of No, he's fine with, and that's also something, you know, something you appreciate about the Matrix movies. And really more or less the what I've seen of the Wachowskis, which again ended with Speed Racer. Not specifically because I wouldn't watch more of their work, just yeah, what they've put out since then hasn't really been something that I, yeah, appealed to me. They do tend to put women as equals to men, you know, and it's not just this thing of you know, this woman is way better than any of the men. It's an equals kind of thing because I'd say there was a time when we needed a lot of stories where it's women are better than men. But you know, at this point, it's more that we're equal. It's because, you know, problems arise when one group specifically is in power. That's why it's also not, it's we shouldn't only have whites or Christians in power either. You know, it's representation for all groups. And yeah, you know, he's just he you know, so she's telling him what to, like, you know, turn on and off and how to, you know, put the power on the, you know, and such. And he's not quite used to her pace. So he's like, come on, keep up. He's, I'm trying, you know, and that's a little bit fun. And we again have too much of the love story. It remains unconvincing. We don't spend enough time with the characters that we care about. And the film ends with us on characters that we don't care. You know, it's not even like we get a good farewell to the character. No, they yeah. And which was what no one wanted. And you end up feeling like, wasn't this trilogy originally about Neo? I feel like it was originally about Neo, but then, you know. And yeah, he's not in a lot of the movie this time around. He doesn't do that much to affect the plot. But then, once The Path of Neo came out, we realized that it's not hard to get too much of Neo moving on his path. Gloria Foster, rest in peace, the Oracle in the first movie and Reloaded, died before finishing her scenes for both Enter the Matrix and this. And they recast her, and it's again this kind of lovable aunt kind of type, with a U, not the insect. And apparently the two of them played sisters in this long-running Broadway, you know, show. So you know, that was something the casting director took into account. And they do explain it. They don't ignore it. You know, that would be really awkward if, but no, they have lines to explain, and it's, you know, I mean, I don't know if they did, like, I haven't heard that they had shot a bunch of this stuff and then had to completely reshoot these scenes because otherwise, like, if they had shot just some of her scenes in Revolutions and it was some of her later scenes, you know, the earlier scene, yeah, that's the kind of thing you try to avoid. And I don't know if they ended up doing that, and I don't know what, you know, the thing they talk about that explains it seems like it was always gonna be in the movie. So I don't know if that just didn't figure much. I don't know if it didn't, what it caused before the recasting, but yeah, it actually is. There is an explanation. It's not one of those really awkward recastings. It would especially be awkward here, given that, you know, we just saw her in Reloaded in the, yeah. and Niobe matters again, and she even has screen time this time around. I do love Jada Pinkett Smith, have ever since Demon Knight, which if you don't know what that is something you need to remedy immediately. We meet the leader of the machines, or maybe just a representative. It's literally called Deus Ex Machina, and for some, it's basically face is made up of a ton of tiny machines that are like, you know, bugs or, yeah, and that is kind of a, you know, that's kind of a cool design. But then they went and based the actual face on like an infant that like one of the Wachowskis had just maybe both, anyway, had just gotten a new nephew or something. And you know how it is when like people, there's just been a new baby in the family, and it's like they're showing pictures to everyone and saying, look, isn't he she cute? I'm not sure directors have done that to a movie audience before, but there you go. We have more awful actors, including a child actor who, and she has all these lines, and they're like supposed to be important. You know, it's not this little, you know, nothing, you know, no, it's, you know, it's Matrix. No, if a character is there, they get, you know, it's unlike the captain's meeting in Reloaded. Here, if there's a character, they actually get lines. They actually get, you know, they're put right in the center of a shot. They get one shots. It's everything, and she just can't act. And a lot of children can't act. But usually, you try to not give them such complex lines, or like, yeah, it's just, or just, yeah, just try not to write too many child characters, and especially don't give them too much. Yeah, as others have noted, Smith was basically Boba Fetted. He was unexpectedly popular. You know, you can understand why we loved him in the first movie, but he wasn't the leader of the machine. He, if anything, he didn't really want to. He wanted out of the Matrix, so it's not as though he. The conflict was between humanity and the machines, and the machines created the Matrix. That's like their big thing. They created the Matrix to enslave us, and then, you know, humanity is trying to fight to free those slaves. Smith didn't care that much about whether, like, he thought it was impressive that the machines were keeping all these slaves, but he wanted out of the Matrix. So why would he be the guy that Neo would then fight if he doesn't really want, you know, he kind of hates the Matrix. He desperately wanted to leave the Matrix. So yeah, and he's given all this undue importance in this and made this really big deal when I don't know what necessarily would have been the plan, or what, you know, what was the plan before they decided that, if there was one. What else would they have done? I'm not saying that I would necessarily, I don't think it would have been an agent, because the agents aren't the guys in charge. They're the muscle for the guys in charge. You know, the architect is the guy in charge, for example. But yeah, I wouldn't have minded it if Agent Johnson had been like someone that Neo would have to fight in a big kind of climax to get to, you know, maybe the architect or some kind, you know, someone in charge. But yeah, you know, it would make sense for the architect to be the major, you know, I suppose you could say he's an antagonist, but he's not in Reloaded that much. He's in this even less, and yeah, he designed the Matrix, especially, you know, and is very much responsible for it being in its current form. So it would make sense if it were him, but yeah. And his quips are still mostly terrible, and he talks a lot more in this than in Reloaded. He's in a lot of this movie. When you really look at it, he's not in that much of Reloaded. He pops in and out, but he doesn't have that much of a presence. He's gone for large chunks of the movie. But in this, it's almost as if when they wrote both of them, they decided that Smith would especially be in this one. But yeah. You know, part of him coming back is, of course, through Bane. There's more really bad dialogue. The Ultimate Matrix collection comes with DVD commentaries for all three movies, with, you know, one commentary with philosophers, I believe Ken Wilber and Cornel West, and then another commentary track by film critics. You know, basically, philosophers who really liked the movie, critics who didn't really like, you know, the trilogy, rather. And I'm going to be noting points of theirs, as, you know, in this. As the critics point out, the multicultural elements of the trilogy do lose some of the impact by these, you know, other ethnicities, non-whites, being kind of gray. They're not that, they don't express their identity that much, which I do, you know, like I already mentioned representation and equality. That is something that there is here when they actually, you know, some of their appearance and such, they do come off as, you know, the black people who have a lot of power aren't like really careful about wielding that power and kind of insecure because it's usually white guys who are in charge. No, they actually say they command. You know, they're not afraid, they're not embarrassed to be in power. They don't act as though they shouldn't have this power and as though the other political party should have more power than they do. I feel like I got sidetracked. But then, at the same time, they don't express as much as you would, you know, as you would like to see. But they do also note that, you know, you have the really rich, largely white, you know, kind of upper class, really rich, you know, in the Matrix itself. In the Matrix, you know, you have these white CIA guys who, you know, who control, and you know, a lot of white cops who also keep the peace, or however you put it. I appreciate actual cops. It's not that. But yeah, the and by actual I mean the ones, you know, I don't just mean the ones not in the fictional world of the Matrix. I mean the ones who don't abuse their power and or cover up for those who abuse their power. You know, you can't be police without policing yourself, policing your own. Anyway, you know, in the Matrix, you have these rich, you know, you have the Merovingians sipping French wine and eating fancy desserts, you know, with or without orgasms. And then, you know, below, down further, you know, literally physically, you know, in this case, below the crust, close to the rich, nuggety center, are, you know, the rest of us, and it's ethnically diverse. it's, you know, women having power as well as men, and they struggle to get by, you know. So there's that kind of commentary on social, you know, yeah, and that, yeah, definitely appreciate it. One of the strengths of the trilogy that genuinely is, you know, that runs strong through all three, you know, there are a lot of things where, you know, these two sequels are a lot less than the first. One thing that is the fact that the crew, the creative forces behind the entire trilogy, it's a lot of the same people. You know, sometimes when you go from one movie to another, you kind of, you know, you maybe decide, I don't think that is the right person. I kind of want this additional movie in the series to have a completely different, you know, the MCU don't keep using the same writers and directors over and over. You know, they do for some, but, you know, the every so often they move on to another one, and which I love. Don't get me wrong. I love that, you know, one of the strengths of the MCU is that it, you know, it hits on so many different places on the spectrum. You know, it creates this vast world with a lot of texture to it. But the Matrix trilogy is decidedly, you know, that's also something, you know, when you read the comic, when you watch the Animatrix, they actually are the comic collection, rather, you know, it's other artists drawing what was designed for the movies and such, but they still tend to try to get fairly close. You know, the Sentinels don't end up looking that different. The agents don't, you know, outside of world record. I mean, and that is something that in the trilogy, it's the same people all through. You know, you might have thought, well, okay, we, you know, John Gaeta created the bullet time for the first movie. Well, let's get someone else to make it even bigger. No, they got John Gaeta back, you know, and said, okay, now make it even bigger, now make it even more impressive, you know. And of course they expanded the crew. They got more people, they got, you know, more, but the you know, Bill Pope is the DP on all three. You know, Jeff Darrow did the designs for all three on the real world stuff. You know, already mentioned John Gaeta for effects design. I want to say Kim Barrett is the name of the, you know, the costume designer. And, you know, these are incredibly talented people. They do amazing work on all three. And because it's the same talented people working on all three, you can tell that it's the same world. It doesn't feel, there's a lot about these two sequels that feels very different from the first. But the overall look and the effects design and such do maintain a certain level of, I want to say the word is verisimilitude. Now, you know, yeah, you can see that it's all the one world. And, you know, I do appreciate that you know, all three of them are R-rated. This, as well, you know, and today, we, you know, they're pushing the PG-13 rating as far as it can go, but it is still the PG-13 rating. And this, you know, you've got violence, blood, not a lot of gore, but definitely violence, and it just does hit harder, you know, when you see someone killed by a Sentinel, and it's not that, oh, it hit them and then they died. No, they actually, you know, they plowed one of their claws straight through the torso of one of them. And it ends up not being particularly gory. It's not like they just explode like that. But, you know, that does have more of an impact than just, oh, well, they were definitely hit, but something, there's no blood, and I don't see any penetration, which I'm not entirely sure you can actually do. That might be an X rating, but, you know, it's bloody, it's violent, it's bleak, it's dark. I've already gone into how bad the opening, with the code rain, kind of thing, how bad that is in Reloaded, when it's quite good in the first one. This one, again, it's fair, it's fine, basically, you know. In the second one, it's hugely operatic, and then it ends up not looking, you know, the very end completely botches it, and in this, it doesn't completely botch it, although, where in the first two, it goes from the green kind of code thing to a real-world object, in this, it just goes to the code on the screen. So it might have been that they just figured, oh, well, we can't make it look as good as in the first, so let's just... Personally, I would have been fine if all three of them opened with something going to the, you know, a flashlight, or, you know, a light shining directly. As a lot have noted, this movie is fun but bad. You know, it's genuinely exciting, and it's just that, you know, when you look at it closer, it falls apart. And some have noted that the first half is pretty bad. I'd say the some of the best is probably the middle of this, where, you know, the big attack on Zion is pretty good. It's not really what we didn't want that much real world action, but it looks really good nevertheless, and it's genuinely exciting. And some have noted it's, you know, all this barely explained nonsense about stuff that you never even heard of, that, you know, at the end, it's not like, oh, that's that. It's more like, what's that? Oh, so that solves it. And it's, you know, it's exciting, but there are a lot of holes in logic and plot. And someone noted, Merovingian doesn't add to the plot in either of these two films. And the storytelling is decidedly average this time around. It feels like they just, you know, kind of, I'd say that they got their groove back after this, so it really is more like it, yeah, you know, by the time they were, once they had written the entire, you know, once they got through the script for Reloaded and started on the one for Revolutions, they were just kind of tired, and they didn't really have that much inspiration left for really compelling storytelling, and yeah. Some say that it was rushed, since it was made at the same time as 2 and Enter the Matrix. I disagree. The problems are in the script, and the script for, you know, both movies and that game were written at the same time. You know, it's not like there are bad effects, or that, like, acting got, like, there's still, you know, some of the acting is, a lot of the acting is basically fine, and there are some performances that are really bad, but no, I would definitely not say that it's an issue of being rushed. We are told in this, mercifully so, that everything that has a beginning does have an end. But in this movie, Both the beginning and end are really, really bad. And someone noted, it is faster paced than Reloaded. It doesn't constantly get bogged down with these really long, you know, not really long exposition, not really long philosophy, not really long action. It feels less full of itself than Reloaded does. And it ends up quite banal. And someone noted the squids really weren't the most interesting part of one. And that is, again, like, you know, I mentioned that Reloaded, a lot of it is just, and this is a carryover from Reloaded, a lot of Reloaded is trying to outdo the first movie. And when, you know, well, the first movie has just a few squiddies, so 250,000, let's see. And you just feel like, wouldn't it make sense to attack with something else? Like the squiddy makes sense for attacking hovercrafts, because they're fast, they grab on, they latch on, and then they use their laser to cut through. Why would you attack a city with that? That doesn't make any sense. Then again, to Morpheus, that does sound exactly like the thinking of a machine. And, you know, when the Sentinels attack Zion, they're like a school of fish or a swarm, and then they also move in this really cool way. There's one bit where they come at this APU, and it almost seems like he's, you know, facing down a storm or something. Where they just hit in, like really heavy waves. Like he's a ship, and there's this horrible storm, and the waves just keep crashing in on him. And that is really quite cool, because at the end of the day, they could have it just be like in the first one, where they just fly down, latch on, and then attack, you know. But no, instead they actually fly in this, they have this formation, and yeah. And where the, you know, in Reloaded, we see that they have these APUs, now they have dozens of them, and at the end, it might come down to just a few of them. And the APU, you know, part of it was really there, so the actor could interact with something. And, you know, they didn't have these big suits that you could walk around in that could fire guns, but they did strap the actor into a suit that does allow them to move the arms, and where, you know, and then they added the CGI, and they didn't erase any of that, they just built on top of it. So, and, you know, yeah, it wasn't like when you take away wires, because they, you know. And one of the things about the real world action is we are deep in the amazing Jeff Darrow's designs, and that just takes a toll on you. It's too long to spend in his intricate and really twisted kind of designs. It looks amazing when there's one squid or one hovercraft, or when it's a comic page and you look over it and there's just all this intricate detail. But when we spend that long with that much of it, and this is, you know, especially the attack on Zion, that's, yeah, that really, that takes a toll. Some have said that the attack on Zion is the only good part. I would definitely say it's the best. It's the one part of the movie that works the best. And it's, you know, it's showing faces, it's, you know, not faces we care about, but nevertheless, there are people there. It's not just CGI banging against CGI. You know, whenever you see an APU, the face is right there. You know, they're not like really covered. It's basically just like wearing, like almost like a jacket or something. They put it on, but it doesn't cover them entirely. It's not supposed to. It, you know, it would slow them down significantly if it did. So, You know, every time you see an APU, either you see the face right then, or you see the face right before or after seeing the APU. You know, there's almost no time in this where you, for an extended period of time, are just watching CG, or just watching, you know, pixels banging against other pixels. And you know, it's showing that, you know, just a few of these, you know, faces that we do recognize. We don't care about them, we do recognize them because they were in Reloaded, accomplishing together what they couldn't do apart. And that is, you know, again, otherwise it would just, you could, if you wanted to, you could cut everything that isn't CGI from the attack on Zion, and it would be hollow and much emptier and less compelling like that. And it really, you know, it's clear that they did really. Like, there's this, you know, the diggers are one of the biggest threats because, you know, I mean, once they enter Zion overall, once they reach the dock, then they're still, you know, they didn't put the habitats right there on the dock, you know, so the machines have to get further, and the way they do that is with the diggers. And then you see these little two-person teams of people, and, you know, a lot of these people you don't know, but, well, yeah, some of them. You see maybe three different of these two-person teams. And one of those teams, you know, one of these people, and yeah, you actually, you know that person, you have stakes, and that person, it's Z, you know, and Z wants, you know, to wants Link to come back, and Link wants to come back to Z. So, you know, both of them are parts of this war, and yeah, you know, that there is something there. And yeah, you see these two-person teams, you know, one of them loads this, you know, double-barrel bazooka thing, and the other person fires it. And they're just trying to take out the legs of these diggers, and you're following them try to shoot. And they do it right. It's not just this thing of every time they fire, they make a huge impact. No, sometimes they miss. Even if they, you know, they can try really hard, it still might not quite work. And that, you know, we wouldn't believe it if every time they fired, they hit perfectly. You know, that would be ridiculous. So, yeah, and we can tell if the battle is going well or not. It's not Attack of the Clones. Very much not Attack of the Clones climax. And yeah, and every so often the status quo will have changed. You know, there's this one bit where you see like a dozen or two APUs firing at where the Sentinels at the one hole that the Sentinels are coming through. And then a little later it cuts back, and then you see there's maybe like three of these APUs left, and it's like, you know, in the time that we didn't need to see one, you know, them be taken out one by one or anything. It tells us, you know, they can only, it's 250,000. They can only slow them down. So, you know, it seems like a pretty hopeless battle. And again, the movie acknowledges that. You know, it's not just, yeah. But yeah, it's not just showing us the exact same thing over and over. It's different things. You know, you spend a little time with the APUs, then you see these two-person bazooka teams. You know, then you see the people who have to reload the APUs, and yeah. And some have noted that there's a lot of aliens in the designs, you know, the Sentinels, the APUs, and a lot of this, yeah. And ultimately, the action does go on for too long. Some have said that, you know, it was genuinely boring, that they ended up not liking it much. I don't think... Oh yeah, maybe some of it is... It's certainly... Some of it really wasn't what we wanted to see. Now... And the movie is fairly straightforward, where again, one was very twisty-turny. One of the things is that we are seeing thousands of individual, very detailed flying sentinels, and it's just... And, you know, there are a ton of moving pieces on each, and it's just too much to take in. It's chaotic. And really, it wouldn't have been that difficult to solve. Like I said, it shouldn't really be sentinels attacking anyway. Why would you send... They're especially good for flying around these tight, narrow passages that the hovercrafts can also fly around, and latching on, you know, scanning for them, then latching on and cutting through them. Why would you send a ton of those flying through a hole when there's an overall city that they already found the target, and it's not narrow? They made a hole. A long, wide hole that leads right into where they want to attack. Why would you send a bunch of little... Yeah. And the way I see it, if they had maybe like one really big attacking machine, you know, go through this hole, and, you know, then it has a lot of different important parts to it, and these parts are being shot off by the APUs and such, you know, and maybe key parts of it are being taken off by the, you know, two-person bazooka teams. And, you know, they should make it clear that these are you know, important parts. You know, put little glowy things on, like make a video game boss fight. It's already very video game action-y. You know, put little glowy things on it that the APUs can shoot, and that gradually, you know, take its power or mobility or something like that. Maybe have little, you know, maybe it sends off a few smaller ones that the APUs then get weakened by, because maybe they're really fast, maybe they're really armored, in some way difficult to shoot. They could still make it look really creepy, but it would be individuals to attack instead of this big wave of, you know, or if it just, like, if they were going to do a wave kind of thing, don't make it a bunch of little living things. Make it an actual, like, maybe they conjure up a storm and throw at, maybe they send waves at, you know, something. But building those waves of tiny little moving things, yeah, that's just too much. Actually, you know, the few diggers are fine to keep, because those, that's where it works. You know, you can tell, okay, they have to shoot those legs because, you know, without the legs, they straight up, the digger will fall and won't be able to. And yeah, you know, that really works. And they do have a few sentinels flying around that, and that also works. That also makes sense. You know, war scenes are difficult to do right today. The effects allowing that level of freedom makes it difficult to rein it in and keep focused. And yeah, the Lord of the Rings war scenes are a lot better than this. The war does feel tense, intense, immediate. It really puts you right there. Similar to Saving Private Ryan and a lot of war movies to come after that, and some that came before. And, you know, effects-wise, there are a ton of different elements at play. You know, you've got live action, miniatures, bigatures, as they also call them, because they are quite big. You know, motion-based, they have these really large sets, and all of this goes together. It blends really well. It makes it feel real. It's always good to try to limit CGI. I think the Christopher Nolan and the Russo brothers, they have it right. Action feels real when there are real elements to it. You know, people say, well, it's still not real. When something is animated, at the end of the day, we can somewhat get a sense that it's animated. And when it's when you're actually blowing up a miniature of something, then the audience feels like something was really just blown up. You know, when it's a set that gets, you know, burnt down or the like, instead of just CG fire, yeah, it makes a difference. CG should, like they say, CG should only be used at the very, you know, to do things that you genuinely cannot do and that you really want to see. You know, there are things in Captain America Civil War that you could not do without CG, but it's only for that it's used. And to do the few things that you do actually do that you can't do with real, you know, limit how much you do that you can't do with live action, and then just to like remove wires and such. But yeah, you know, we can tell that the Batmobile is really there, you know, the Tumbler. Not everybody is a fan of calling it the Batmobile and prefer earlier versions of the Batmobile. But yeah, you know, at the end of the day, these effects come off really impressive, but that isn't enough to make it a good film. Although there is this one shot that's really terrible, and it doesn't last for very long, maybe a few seconds, but it really, I don't know what happened there, but it's a ton of like Sentinels flying at, you know, toward the viewer, and yeah, it just looks terrible. But almost all of the effects look amazing in the movie. And there are 804 effect shots, and almost all of them have some kind of live-action element. The water physics in this are amazing. And, you know, at the end of the day, the attack on Zion does go on for a really long time. And as some have pointed out, if it wasn't in a Matrix movie, if it wasn't in a, you know, if the first Matrix movie hadn't been so amazing, nobody would be defending that this is just a lot of effects. At the end of the day, it is, you know, it's not martial arts. It's not, you know, actual vehicular. It's effects, you know. A lot of movies have a lot of effects, you know, going, yeah, flying against each other, shooting each other and such, that we would never praise or defend the weaknesses of. That, yeah, you know, some have said, I mean, Battlefield Earth has a huge action climax as well, and that's, that movie. The critics point out that the spy infiltration kind of, you know, action base was in the first one was better than this war. So, you know, what the Wachowskis did there was really impressive. There was stuff there that we'd never seen before, you know, especially not in a movie. This kind of thing of the, you know, there's a lot about the first one that is really comic book like, where, you know, if you've read comic books, you recognize this kind of logic and such, and it works. You know, it's an action movie. It doesn't have to be, you know, stuff that could that completely has like real world counterparts. And it's not set in our world. Basically, it's the movie is not the Matrix franchise is not about how the real world has these, you know, like there are action movies that place things in our, you know, a lot of the MCU very, you know, tries to ground itself in our world, in our sense of reality. But the Matrix never really did that. That, you know, right away, things happen that were, you know, someone's writing on your computer screen. You get a phone FedEx to your at your office, and immediately, someone calls it. These are not things, you know, you get told what's going to happen, and then it happens. These are not things that happen in the real world. And so it can get away with a lot of things like that. But when it comes to just a war film kind of story, there's not that much that's that interesting. You know, I mean, the you have one side that are trying to hold down the fort, and then you have another side that's trying to, you know, breach the walls around and then get in and then attack. That's it. There's nothing mind-bending there. There's nothing that interesting there. And it boils down to just a war film, and it puts in all the war film cliches. And then there's this other action scene that's basically the lobby shootout, just not as interesting. It even opens the exact same way. There's a sudden, unexpected, dramatic entrance of our heroes into the lobby. The person who first realizes that it's dangerous is quickly dispatched of, although in this case not killed. And it really makes you stop and wonder, did the Wachowskis not have that many cool ideas for action? And we later find out, you know, I don't like Speed Racer, but it's got really cool, interesting action, and the way it's covered, and this kind of, you know, it, the camera dances around in scenes in Speed Racer that aren't bullet time, for example. So they did have more. It just, yeah, it seems like they pushed themselves a little too far on this one and eventually ran out of cool stuff. And, you know, the fact that the game Enter the Matrix also has a lot of lobby shootouts makes you kind of deja vu. Must have changed something in the Matrix. Yeah, I realize that they're not the ones completely in charge of that, but it still does make you kind of feel like maybe they didn't have as many. And really, Enter the Matrix, a lot of the action setups are just, this is just like the, you know, what you saw in at least one of the movies. That, yeah. Apologies, had to edit out a spoiler. I do feel like, you know, you, in Enter the Matrix, you do get to fly the hovercraft some, but it's just, you know, you direct and then you hold down forward. You know, that's it. It's very simple. And I do think that they could make a more complex, I don't know if it should be a straight up flight simulator kind of thing, but just something more complex. Because in Enter the Matrix, yeah, it's very straightforward. It's very limited. And, you know, with what we see in this, with how Niobe says, okay, now put the power there, now do that, you feel like, well, it could, you know, you could make a game where you have to do at least some of that. So, yeah. fly it more freely. In this lobby shootout, the bad guys jump up on the ceiling and then shoot from there. Because the Wachowskis could and the characters could. It is kind of cool that they did actually do that with wirework. They didn't flip up, they didn't build a set where the floor looked like the ceiling and then they combined, filming. No, these guys actually walked on the ceiling, so that's cool. And we do get to see Seraph use pistols, which, in Reloaded, we don't even know if he carries them. And we get to see Morpheus dual-wield SMGs, and it's two different ones, too, so that's cool. And Seraph, right before they shoot, he kind of checks the guns, where, like, you pull it back to see if the shell is, if there's a shell at the very, if there is one at the very top, so it's ready to fire. And he does this and one or two other things, and it's such a badass little bit. So again, they weren't completely out of really cool things that they could have them do. And though there are only a few action scenes in this, some of them really go on forever. And very little of the action is actually very cool. The real-world action hits harder, but it's just really not what we want. These scenes are pretty lame. And there's far too much real-world in this movie. Most of the movie is set in the real world, which you can understand because the machines are right there. It's not gonna, they're arriving and we have to deal with them. But again, that's not what anybody wanted. When we watched the first movie, we wanted to see them keep, we especially want to see them in the Matrix, but if not that, at least in the Construct, in a training program or something. We didn't want to see them in the real world a lot. That's the whole point. We're fighting to stop that dreary existence in the real world. And the action is slightly better spaced out than Reloaded, but it is still basically in specific chunks. And the climactic battle between Neo and Smith, which, we all knew that it was coming, that even if you didn't watch any of the trailers, we knew that it had to come down between Neo and Smith. And this fight is in the pouring rain because, it's Neo, Smith has done some bad stuff, and bad stuff means rain. And basically, it's not quite regular rain. It's kind of got this quality to it that makes it similar to the, iconic Matrix code rain. So, yeah, that's pretty cool. And in that fight, there's, some martial arts, and that's really cool and enjoyable. But then there's also this kind of Dragon Ball kind of stuff. So, they swapped animes, and the thing is just that Akira works better as a big Hollywood action blockbuster than Dragon Ball. And it's not, I read a little bit of Dragon Ball, and I never really watched it much, but I read some, and, it's good. It's not that it's bad, it's just that it doesn't really work for this really big blockbuster kind of thing. That's where Akira, a lot of the way, really does. I mean, you have to change some of the things from Akira, a lot of the psychic stuff they didn't put in, but then that's it. Where in Dragon Ball, the way they fight is just not. There are things that you can animate where you use real people, and some of what they do corresponds to what we can do, what the human body can do, but where you can animate it into doing something that just isn't going to work in live action, even if you have them apparently do it in live action. You know, a lot of it is, of course, animated, and then some of it is done with wire work, and it just doesn't look as good. It doesn't work as well. It feels like we're just watching something. We're not experiencing it. It's not real. We're just watching a show. You know, you've got air-to-air fighting, you've got Supermaning kind of, you know, stuff that doesn't feel organic to the franchise. And they've noted that it's like Jack Kirby action, you know, throwing each other through buildings and then getting up for more. And here it just doesn't work as well. It's not grounded enough in reality. It takes place in the Matrix, yes, but we still have to have, you know, so was all the stuff in the first two, but there was still some level of, even no matter how much Neo flew, there was still some level of consequence of something that you could do, and then there would be something that you would, yeah, you know, you could only push it that far. And it's not that Jack Kirby action, I love Jack Kirby action, you know, and it's not that it can't work at all on the silver screen. In Spider-Man 2, one character throws a car at another character. I'm not a big fan of the Raimi trilogy, you know, Raimi Spider-Man trilogy, but that scene works a lot better than the Jack Kirby action in this, because it's grounded in reality, because you understand how the strength to throw that car, where that came from, and you see the car actually break stuff, you know, there, yeah, you have to ground it in reality if you're gonna do it in live action. If they had done it purely in, like, there are full CG movies that can get away with stuff, even though the characters look human, very lifelike human, it's still, at the end of the day, you know. And there are so many goofy moments in that fight as well. And really, the action, it's two big climactic battles and just characters flying to get to those battles. That's it. There's nothing else really happens in this. It's too effects driven. And the final conclusion is they work as allegory, but they're just not satisfying for the audience. It's a really big anticlimax. The philosophy, there's less of it here than, you know, in the first two. And again, some of it is followed up on, but a lot of it isn't in the philosophy from 2. And, you know, though there is now, you know, a better balance between action and philosophy, this is still stuff that we didn't really want, not what the trilogy was sold on. Not this much real world, not this much real world action, and not a war film. This is nowhere near as rewatchable as the first two. I've rewatched all three a number of times. Like I mentioned before in these videos, I bought these films not long after they came out, you know, and watched them, yeah, a million times. And with this one, it's just, yeah, it's a lot less rewatchable. It's just, it's less cool to watch. It's, you know, the philosophy is, there's less of it, and it just doesn't have the punch. And yeah, and ends up kind of tedious. It really is amazing that the Wachowskis had a career after the disappointment of this, after two films right after each other that were such disappointments and were such letdowns on, like, a concept that we really wanted more of. You know, like, the fact that they got to do other big concepts after this is really, yeah. And as others have noted, the end credits run to a choir, not a Rage Against the Machine song. You know, in the first two, the moment the credits start running, you know, they kick up a Rage Against the Machine song, and that is kind of, that's what we, you know, this movie leaves us on something else, leaves us with something else. And yeah, when in the first two, it was this, you know, if it made you feel like even just watching this movie, you were rebelling against this conformist world that we all hate, but we don't know how to get out of. And yeah, in this, not so. And the movie runs 2 hours and 4 minutes, not counting the end credits, and 2 hours and 9 minutes with. So, you know, also a little shorter. And the, you know, when, you know, as the attack on Zion proceeds, you know, you worry if these raving loons will make it. And when, after the Matrix came out, there was, when Max Payne 1 came out, and a little bit after Max Payne 2, at least, I think I lost interest in it not long after Max Payne 2, you know, yeah, I spent significantly, you know, Max Payne 1 came out in 2001, so, yeah, until 2003, we really cared about this, you know, and, yeah, something that was pretty popular and that we saw amazing mods with was, of course, The Matrix. And, you know, I worked on a few, and at the risk of making my contribution sound more impressive than it was very little of a contribution. I didn't work on very many, I didn't do that much. The moment that it goes 3D, I'm not that great. I did some level design that was decent, but when it comes to crafting stuff with games, I was far, far better with stuff like StarCraft and Heroes of Might and Magic 3, especially StarCraft, because you could really play around with triggers in that and program levels very, very differently. I did a lot of Aliens versus Predator kind of stuff, because there's, in case you've never played StarCraft or you don't know anything about Aliens or Predators, those franchises, there's a bit of overlap. The people who made StarCraft very clearly, there's a real sense that they watched every James Cameron movie and loved it. Like, there's a ton of references to his work and a lot of, you know, yeah, a lot that looks like the various creatures and such. Anyway, each time, you know, obviously a lot was made, you know, before, you know, between 2001 and 2003, a lot of mods were made. You know, you got to play as characters in the first Matrix, and a lot of the first Matrix, you know, the construct, the lobby, the subway, you know, all of these, when Reloaded came out, then of course people did, you know, recreated the chateau, the tea house, and, you know, such. And yes, the chateau, of course, completely came apart. Everything in it could be destroyed. And, of course, excuse me, Enter the Matrix also I have the chateau. But once the Animatrix came out, then the elements were taken from there. You know, I saw one where when you kill someone, they would kind of, you know, as they die, they bleed, and someone made them bleed Matrix code, a la, I want to say, Program? I want to say it's Program, but yeah, the one where the I want to say Sis and Duo are the names, that they, yeah, argue over the whole kind of cipher situation going on in that. Then this came out. Not a lot of people modded a lot of this. Anyway, this movie can go know itself. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box.